actually have quite a bit more for you, but we did want to give an opportunity for people to ask some questions. But we don't have a lot of time, so please make it brief and to the point so that we can maximize what we can accomplish here. Anybody have any questions for the panelists?
Yes, I have a question. What is BRICS abbreviated for?
Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa.
Thank you.
Great. That was good.
Excellent. Kathleen?
I'm so very excited about this. But I'd like to know how to get it moving at a faster speed. I mean, I looked at the website, this 500 and yesterday, 30 some odd signatures out of the 500,000 Mr. LaRouche ones.
As I said before, everyone here should get every organization that they are a part of or aware of mobilized behind this. This affects everyone. We also need, we should organize delegations to visit our legislators to demand that they take action, that they should sign on, but they ought to put legislation forward. This has to be done. You probably have other ideas. Sure. Can you stand up?
And please use the mic. People might be able to hear you, but this is for a recording.
Okay. You just asked, you know, what we can do to get this moving at a faster speed, and there's no easy answer, but I was thinking about the kind of money that it would take to build this fortification of the electric grid, pennies on the dollar. Well, we all, every one of us does a little something. That's like pennies on the dollar, but it creates this big movement. Every one of us told everyone we know about this, gave them the information, donated, signed petitions, passed it around. That's a lot of people. And if we all do that, and if everyone, every other conference does that, we can do it. I worked 70 hours a week to be able to come to this conference. It's not a lot, but because of that, I registered for this event for $50, I contributed in $100, and I can continue to do more. I don't know what you guys can do, but you can do something.
Yeah. 100% right. Our political movement has a lot that we can spend on this. For example, we're about to produce I believe it's 24-page pamphlet on the New Silk Road and the World Land Bridge and U.S. joining the BRICS. And that's going to be essential to mobilize the U.S. population. We need to have 1 million copies of that on the streets as soon as possible. Mrs. LaRouche called on us to organize conferences like this one. I believe this is the second one. This would be another in Houston, I believe, next Thursday. And then on Saturday, there'll be a major conference in this series in New York City. And everywhere where we organize, there has to be a conference as soon as possible. But we do need to flood the streets with this material. And financing that by contributing to the various organizations involved in this mobilization is essential.
I was just going to say that there's also copies of the petition on our road to 500,000. We have copies of the petition on the literature table outside. So everyone, before you leave, just make sure that you sign it if, of course, you think the BRICS is actually a viable alternative to thermonuclear war.
David?
I have kind of half-formed thought. I'll give you what I've got of it so far. Look at what we've heard today. We have what Andrea Bowen said about the EMP threat and the refusal of the in a ERC to do anything about it. As she emphasized, this is a existential threat. She doesn't say, you know, if I understood you correctly, we're talking about the survival of the human race, not just of this country. Is that true?
They could be that large, yes.
Yes. Second of all, we have the threat of diseases like Ebola. We have Ebola itself, and we have other cases where the big pharma is not doing anything. And in fact, we have the proposition that they've just stopped. At least in this country, they have. So those things together, you see a picture. I think that where these fit together is that the more the economy is financialized, the less the needs of the human race are being addressed. You know, the classic example is the one you gave, where you shut down a plant because you can get more profits by shutting it down than you can by protecting the human population. Okay. Now, and then even on the India projects that we've heard about, there's a ceiling on how effective they can be under the current world system. But if you implement BRICS and you start building industry, then those projects are much more effective, and they don't just stop at a certain level. They change the world. They're part of changing the world. But now here's the thing. Even among our most gutsy people, a lot of us don't like to talk about something that we know, namely that the oligarchs, the old families that are running this world, want the population of the world to be reduced to, you know, from 7 billion to 1 billion, or thereabouts. Now, that was recently reconfirmed by a paper or a conference paper that came out of London. Somebody can possibly give the citation, I can't. So then these things fit together very nicely. Now you've got this financialization process that's undercutting our existence, potentially destroying all or almost all the human race. That's what the oligarchs are after. So if they don't get us with their nuclear war, they're going to get us with that, with the financialization. And they take a little longer. So that is the difference between the BRICS system and what we've got now, isn't that it? Because the BRICS system is not a system in which financialization benefits anybody. It's dedicated to productive economy. So I think the way to accelerate this movement is to pose the existential threat from these different angles. And say to people, look, prove me wrong. You think things are going to go on the way they are? No. I mean, even on the kind of simplistic level, people responded to this questionnaire saying, Americans responded to the questionnaire saying, no, I think our next generation is going to be worse off. Well, maybe it may be worse than just worse off. It may not be there.